All right, let's take our Bibles and turn to the book of Proverbs and chapter 21. Proverbs chapter 21, verse 1. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of water, he turneth it whithersoever he will. I've loved this verse for many, many years. It's a great verse. And I'm going to show you some great things from the Bible that prove what it means. And we'll expand on it a little bit as well. Got him. Tell you, if I ever die, I'd like to die on the Bible like this little insect did. Good place to die, amen? He died right on is, but he isn't anymore. He used to be is, but he isn't anymore is. You know he was. Okay. Big fuzzy was he? Was a bear, big fat, was a worm, a big fat worm was he. Climbed upon the railroad track, the train he did not see. Ooh. Oh, no, it's ooey gooey, yeah. Ooey gooey was a worm. Big fat worm was he, yeah. Oh, I messed it up.
Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear.
Yeah, Fuzzy Wuzzy was a bear, yeah. Huh? Okay, ooey gooey was a worm. Big fat worm was he. He climbed upon the railroad track, the train he did not see. Ooey gooey. That's all I know. Is there more to it than that? You never heard that? Okay. Anyway. Okay. All righty. Funny things you learn in church, huh? Okay. All right, let's pray. Father, bless us as we study your word, and I pray that you'd give us wisdom and help us also to, sometimes, you know, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So this verse should teach us the fear of the Lord, which will help us to get to the root of having wisdom. And so bless us, we pray, as we study your word, and we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of water, he turneth it whithersoever he will. What this verse means is that God holds the heart of every king and of every, as you know, I like to apply head of household to the term king, because we're kings of our castles. It's a doctrine called the castle doctrine that many states recognize in law. But anyway, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. So the heart of man is in the hand of the Lord, basically. And as the rivers of waters, you ever look at a river? Have you ever seen, look on a map and ever seen a river that goes straight? You may find a section that's straight when you're canoeing or something, but they don't go straight very long. They turn this way and that way. Some they double back and they just go all over. So God is able to turn people's hearts any direction, any way, in an unusual way. Wow, we can be surprised. That's why you can be surprised that people end up making certain decisions, because everybody's heart, especially the king's heart, leaders, the heart of leaders is in the hand of the Lord. And God operates, he rules the world. God sits on his throne, see, and he wrote the code by which we all live by, or by which we live and you know, in him we move, live and move and have our being. So we be or we exist because of God. He wrote our DNA code. And so when he gave us free will, but when we make decisions that affect, that are affected by laws that he's established. I like to use the illustration of a computer game. A man can write a program so that no matter what you decide to do at any point during the game, there are certain consequences. See, if you, I'm trying to think of some computer game. Who knows a computer game that's simple? It'd be easy to, huh?
Minesweeper.
Okay, Minesweeper. Yeah, I've seen that one before. That's an old game. It's one like one of the originals. But anyway, so it doesn't matter. There's all these squares that you can click on, but it's already written. You can't see what's underneath those until you click on them. But you can decide which block to click on. The game doesn't make you choose any particular block. See? So, but your action then kicks in something that's already pre-written that you didn't know about. And it could be good. Sometimes you click on, in that game, if I remember correctly, they have numbers, right? They have numbers and they have bombs. Bottom line is that you have free will in that game. Once you decide to get in the game. And so we have free will once we get born. See? But what you decide has an effect on you. You can decide to go to the store and get something you need, or you can decide not to go to the store. If you go to the store and get what you need, you'll get what you need. But you might see somebody along the way who might say, "Hey, how you doing?" And, "Hey, I heard something good about you this week." And they might just make your day. Or you may run across someone who says, who gets mad at you because they think you cut them off in traffic and they cuss you out. Then you go home miserable. Either way, you go to the store, but there's other things that happen. No matter what you decide to do, there's other things, there's other players involved. And you can't control what they do. But anyway, so God, the heart of the King is the head, Lord. God knows all the possibilities. And He knows all the laws. He knows how people respond when people cuss them out. He knows how you're going to respond. He knows how you respond if someone's really nice to you. He knows how you'll respond if you hear from somebody you haven't heard, you meet somebody, "Hey, are you? I haven't seen you since grade school." You know, God knows how you can respond. He knows that that might cause you to "Hey, let's get together." And then you get home and tell your wife about it. She says, "Did you get the bread and milk?" "Oh, I forgot." I mean, God knows how everything is going to affect you. And so the King's heart is in the hand of the Lord. Now, let's first of all, second of all, I guess, because I talked about that, but let's go to the Bible and see proof of this and how that God literally, and kings in the Bible, how He handled their heart, turned their heart, okay? Turn to Exodus chapter 4. Exodus chapter 4 and verse 21. The Bible says, "And the Lord said unto Moses, When thou goest to return into Egypt, see that thou do all those wonders before Pharaoh," like throw your rod down and it'll turn into a snake, put your hand in your bosom, bring it out, it'll be leprous, put it back in, it'll be okay, so forth. "See that you do these things. But I will harden his heart." This is God saying, "I will harden Pharaoh's heart, that he shall not let the people go." So does Pharaoh have any chance of not having his heart hardened?
No.
Now, do you know why? Does he have free will?
Yeah.
Yeah, he has free will. Is God going to interfere with his free will?
Yes.
No. God's going to use his free will to, according to his knowledge. God knows Pharaoh does not want to let his people go.
Right.
So God's going to try to get him to let him go, knowing he doesn't want to, which will cause him to dig in his heels. "No, I'm not going to let your people go." So he's going to harden his heart. His heart's going to get harder and harder. See? Because God's going to send Moses back and back and back and back. And eventually he's going to give in, and then he's going to be sorry he gave in. And God knows all this ahead of time. So God is telling him, "Go and show all these wonders to Pharaoh." And you'd think that after seeing all these wonders, that Pharaoh said, "Oh, God, this God that you serve that gives you part of this, is wants me to let him go. Oh, okay, I'll let him go." But no, Pharaoh does not believe in God. Not our God. Not the God of the Bible. He believes in the Nile River is a God. He believes in all kinds of gods. Sun God, moon God, all kinds of gods. So, and God knows that. And so God says, "I'm going to send you to Pharaoh, show him all these things, and I'll harden his heart that he shall not let the people go." All right? Now, let's go to chapter 9. Exodus chapter 9, verse 12. See, God's going to harden Pharaoh's heart for our sake. Pharaoh's not going to let him go anyway. So God is going to use his refusal to provide a wonderful example to us of how that God can turn the heart of someone to do, not just say no once, but to create a whole scenario where they go through 10 plagues, you know, and it prevents, and there's a lot of principles we learn. So sometimes the father-in-law, a son's not going to do something, he's going to disobey him. So the father's going to create all kinds of scenarios, or he's going to say things so that he can teach that son more lessons from his disobedience. So anyway, God's a great teacher. And he's teaching us. Pharaoh doesn't want to learn. So he uses Pharaoh to teach us. All right, Exodus chapter 9 and verse 12. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he hearkened not unto them as the Lord had spoken unto Moses. Now this is after, you know, God sent boils upon people. And but the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, and he hearkened not unto them, just like God told him. All right, now let's skip down to verse 14. Let's keep on going, verse 13. And the Lord said unto Moses, rise up early in the morning and stand before Pharaoh and say unto him, thus saith the Lord God of the Hebrews, let my people go that they may serve me. For I will at this time send all my plagues upon thine heart. See, God's after his heart. I will send at this time all my plagues upon thine heart and upon thy servants and upon thy people, that thou mayest know that there is none like me in all the earth. See? So God hardens Pharaoh's heart. Now, we know from the end of the story how that... Let me go over to chapter 12. All right, look at verse 29. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote, this is the last plague, the killing of the firstborn in all the land, if they don't put the blood on the doorposts and the lintel. And it came to pass that at midnight the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, from the firstborn of Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in the dungeon, and all, now this firstborn of everybody, top to bottom, and all the firstborn of cattle. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there's a great cry in Egypt. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine if God did that here to Phoenix? And at midnight, people woke up, they'd been warned about this, but didn't believe it. And then they wake up, everybody wakes up, they begin to lament, oh, just like I think if the American people don't wake up, God's going to send judgment on this nation. There's going to be an hour and a day when people are going to wake up and say, and they're going to lament, oh, if only, you know, and it's too late. That's what's going on in Egypt. Everybody's waking up to find their firstborn is dead. And there's a great cry going up throughout all the land. And so there's a great cry in Egypt, and there was not a house where there was not one dead. I mean, of the Egyptian's house. Israelites, of course, they obeyed Moses. There was not a house where there's not one dead. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night, so after midnight, and said, rise up and get you forth from among my people, both ye and the children of Israel, and go and serve the Lord as ye have said. Also take your flocks and your herds as ye have said, and be gone, and bless me also. So, God's been hardening Pharaoh's heart. Now, he decides to let him go. But, it doesn't last long. Chapter 14. And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, that they turn and encamp before Pi-hahiroth, between Migdal and the sea over against Baal-zephon. Before it ye shall encamp by the sea. For Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are entangled in the land. The wilderness hath shut them in. Now will harden Pharaoh's heart, that he shall follow after them. And I will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his host, meaning his army, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. And they did so. And it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and of his servants was turned against the people. Who turned their hearts? The Lord. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and he turneth it whither as the rivers of water, he turns it whithersoever he will. And so, the heart of Pharaoh and of his servants was turned against the people, and they said, why have we done this? That we have let Israel go from serving us. I mean, they've been doing all this work, now we got to do it. What was wrong with us? And he made ready his chariot and took his people with him. See, Pharaoh went too. He didn't just stay behind. Pharaoh drowned in the Red Sea too, by the way. Anyway, so he took his people with him. And he took 600 chosen chariots and all the chariots of Egypt and captains over every one of them. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And he pursued after the children of Israel, and the children of Israel went out with an high hand. And then you get to about verse 13, and Moses said to the people, the people are scared because they see the army coming up behind them. And Moses says, fear ye not, stand still and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show to you today. For the Egyptians who ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel, that they go forward, but lift up thou up thy rod. So we've got to go forward, but there's a Red Sea there. But God has Pharaoh lift up his rod, sends an east wind that blows all night, and separates the waters, stands them up in a heap, and dries the ground, and the people pass over. And of course, the Egyptians, they think, hey, if they can do it, we can do it too. And they go down there, and then God sends angels down to take the wheels off their chariots. They get bogged down in the middle of the Red Sea, so they can't move very fast. And children of Israel get out, and then God has Moses turn around and hold his rod over the Red Sea, and they get pummeled with heavy, heavy waves as the sea comes crashing in on them once again like a flash flood. And they're like a mouse in a washing machine. They get crushed and they get all disoriented and they're drowned. And in the morning, the Israelites see their bodies on the seashore. So, but God hardened the king's heart. He turned it whithersoever he willed. God decided to judge Egypt and the whole military for the way they've been treating his people all those years. See, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. And God repays really good. So, anyway, so there's that story. Now, let me show you another verse. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee and to prove thee, to know what was in thine heart, whether thou wouldest keep his commandments or no. Did you know God knows the future of your life? God knows what you're going to do for him or not do for him in the future. He knows whether you're going to stand for him or not in the future. He knows if you're going to wimp out. He knows if you're going to be like Peter and betray somebody. God knows your heart, see, and that he'll use that knowledge to turn you whatever way he wants to, like a river that goes, meanders all over the place. He'll turn you just perfect to interact with somebody else to accomplish something he once accomplished, see. I marvel. That's why one of the things, side benefits of going soul winning, I marvel at the people I meet and the people I'm able to win to Christ. You know, if it was up to me to try to find people who will get saved, I couldn't do it. Because I don't know their hearts, but God knows their hearts. And me, I thought about it. Mark and I talked about it last time we went out and we were having those. I suggested, didn't I, that maybe we ought to go to another place. Remember that? Maybe we ought to try another street. Do you remember that? Vaguely? Anyway, I didn't say it with Brother Jesse, but I was thinking it. I was thinking, you know, this street's just not a good street. Maybe we ought to just not worry about finishing it. But no, I kept on going. Why? The Bible says so. Every house. House to house. Every creature. So it's amazing that God can put us through time and time and time where we go, you know, door after door after door, nobody answers, or people look up the screens, but they don't answer. We hear them talk in the house, but they don't come to the door. And it can get discouraging if you let it, but I don't let it discourage me. Why? Hey, at least I'm checking off a house. And if they had a chance to come to the door and they didn't come, that's their fault, not mine. I'm doing my job, okay? I'm doing my duty, and that's my duty to do, is do what God's commanded me to do. I'm not commanded to win souls, I'm commanded to preach the gospel. Go house to house. So I'm going to do my duty. Their duty is to answer the door and listen and trust Christ's Savior if they need to. I can't do their duty. I can only do mine. So that's how I handle it. So often it happens. You know, let's just call it a day. No one's interested today. Well, no one we've talked to so far. But what if the next person's interested? See? And that's the way it was. The last door we knocked on, we had 30 minutes to go. And I remember times, Brother Jesse, you may have been with me in the times because you maybe have memories of this before, where I have done that very thing. You know, let's call it a night. I know, Brother Mark, you've been with me when I've done that. Every time. Now, I don't do it because I'm just discouraged. Sometimes because I got other pressing things to do. And, hey, if people aren't responding well, okay. I'm going to be back out. I'm going to be back where I left off, more than likely. But sometimes I do that. But then sometimes I decide, well, let's do one more house. And we had 30 minutes to go last night. And guess what? Ended up taking 45 minutes, so we went a little overtime, or maybe, I don't know how long. But anyway, but that last guy got saved, see? So the Lord knows our hearts. He knows what's in our heart. And God is going to match people up, see? We just need to be willing to go where God wants to go and say what God wants us to say, do what God wants us to do. All right? Okay, now, let's go to 2 Kings chapter 19. This is a great story. Another great proof, the fact that God is able to turn the heart of a king. And this is an extra special good story. I love this one because of the intrigue. 2 Kings chapter 19. And verse 20. Then Isaiah the son of Amos sent to Hezekiah, saying, Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, That which thou hast prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria, I have heard. This is the word that the Lord hath spoken concerning him. The virgin, the daughter of Zion, hath despised thee and laughed thee to scorn. The daughter of Jerusalem hath shaken her head at thee. God is reminding Sennacherib, or Hezekiah, of what's going on with Sennacherib, king of Assyria. Now, skip down to verse 27. God is now talking about Nebuchadnezzar. But I know thy abode, and thy going out, and thy coming in, and thy rage against me. Because thy rage against me and thy tumult has come up into mine ears, therefore I will put my hook in thy nose, and my bridle in thy lips, and I will turn thee back by the way by which thou camest. Nebuchadnezzar does not know it, but God has a hook that he can hook in people's noses. And he's got a bridle that he can put on people's lips. And he can turn them and get them to do whatever he wants them to do, because God has all kinds of tools. More tools than we know. Just like God can send weather to cause us to not do something. Or he can use weather to cause us to do something. You ever wake up someday and thinking, I'm going to take it easy? Then you walk outside and think, man, this is nice. All of a sudden you have the urge to do something that earlier you didn't have. See? Sometimes God uses weather to motivate us. Sometimes God uses somebody else. Like I gave illustrations before. Someone cussing you out can change your day, can't it? Someone complimenting you. Someone get a phone call from a long-lost friend or from somebody, can change your day. All of a sudden, you change your schedule. All of a sudden, you go to the boss and say, hey, by the way, what if you get a call from home? Hurry, hurry, hurry. got an emergency. Something's going on here. I'm scared. And you go to your boss. Say, hey, see you later. I just got a call from my wife. There's an emergency home. I'll call you and let you know how it goes, whether I'm coming back. And you just leave. See? A phone call can change your life. God has so many tools. A sickness can change your life. You can have all kinds of plans, and all of a sudden, you get sick. All of a sudden, maybe you get in an accident, or you hurt yourself, you fall. And all of a sudden, you can't do all the things you planned on doing. Or maybe it's the opposite. Maybe you're sick a lot. And all of a sudden, God gives you reprieve from that sickness, and you have good health for a while. And say, wow, boy, now you feel like doing some things you've never felt like doing in a long time. So God has all kinds of tools. He can turn us. So our heart is in the hand of the Lord, and the king's heart specifically. And this is written so that we can trust the Lord. Sometimes when someone who is over us and bearing down on us, being oppressive, you know, all we can do is cry out to God, and God can turn their heart. See? I love the verse from Proverbs. We have already looked at it, I believe, in our studies. It says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. God can turn the heart of other people who, before, they weren't at peace with you, and all of a sudden now they want peace. See? So, you know what we ought to do? Make sure that our ways please the Lord. And then trust God to do what he says he can and would do. Turn the heart of other people so they'll be at peace with us, even our enemies. Okay? Now turn to Jeremiah 21, verse 4. Thus saith the Lord God of Israel, behold, I will turn back the weapons of war that are in your hands, wherewith ye fight against the king of Babylon and against the Chaldeans which besiege you without the walls, and I will assemble them into the midst of this city. God is able to turn back things that are in our hand. We think we control what's in our hand. God is able to turn it back. A guy can have a tool in his hand or a weapon and have an intent in his heart, and God can turn his hand back to where all of a sudden, you know, I think I'll just holster this. I think I'm going to unload this. I think I'm going to put it away. You know, God can save at the last minute. God can do some amazing things. He is able to turn the heart of kings. All right? Turn to 1 Kings chapter 21. 1 Kings chapter 21. This is a good one. And verse 17. And the word of the Lord came to Elijah the Tishbite, saying, arise, go down to meet Ahab, king of Egypt, which is in Samaria. Behold, he is in the vineyard of Naboth, where he has gone down to possess it. Remember that story, how he wanted Naboth's vineyard? And his wife, Naboth wouldn't sell, so he went home and pouted. His wife took measures in her own hand and hired some people to lie about him and accuse him of blasphemy and have him and his son stoned to death so there'd be no inheritors. And he says, all right, now I got your vineyard for you. Now go possess it. So here he is, Ahab, following like a wimpy man his wife's evil doings. And he goes down to possess it, and God tells Elijah to go down and meet him there. All right? Now, verse 19. And thou shalt speak unto him, saying, thus saith the Lord, hast thou killed and also taken possession? And thou shalt speak unto him, saying, thus saith the Lord, in the place where dogs licked the blood of Naboth, shall dogs lick thy blood, even thine. And Ahab said to Elijah, hast thou found me, O mine enemy? And he answered, I have found thee, because thou hast sold thyself to work evil in the sight of the Lord. Behold, I will bring evil upon thee, and I will take away thy posterity, and will cut off from Ahab him that pisseth against the wall, that's all the males, and him that is shut up and left in Israel. And I will make thine house like the house of Jeroboam the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah. By the way, you go back and look in the Bible, you'll find that God says the same thing about the children of Jeroboam, the children of Baasha, that the dogs will eat them. Okay? Anyway, for the provocation which thou hast provoked me to anger and made Israel to sin. And of Jezebel also spake the Lord, saying, the dogs shall eat Jezebel, by the wall of Jezreel. Him that dieth of Ahab in the city, the dogs shall eat, and him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat. That's what the same thing, that verse, verse 24, is what's said about the descendants of Jeroboam, the descendants of Baasha. Anyway, I came across that while studying for this. Now, so, sounds pretty bad, huh? God prophesies, or God foretells through Elijah that Ahab, dogs are going to lick his blood in the same place where dogs licked up the blood of Naboth and his sons after they were stoned to death. Let's go to 2 Chronicles chapter 18. 2 Chronicles chapter 18. Notice, keep in mind, we're doing this to show how the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. 2 Chronicles chapter 18. And we'll start at verse 21. 18, actually. This is Micah, the prophet, speaking to Ahab. Again, he said, "Therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting upon his throne, and all the host of heaven standing on his right hand and on his left. And the Lord said, Who shall entice Ahab, king of Israel, that he may go up and fall at Ramoth-Gilead?" Now, keep in mind, here's the scenario. Micah has a vision from God, or God's telling him to say this, that he saw, he says, the Lord said, hear the word of the Lord, I saw the Lord sitting upon his throne, and all the host, the army of heaven, standing on his right hand and on his left. All the angels. And the Lord said to these angels, who shall entice Ahab, king of Israel, that he may go up and fall at Ramoth-Gilead? Did you know angels, by the way, right hand and left hand. You know God's going to separate the sheep from the goats. Sheep on his right hand, goats on the left. So it might be God assembles all the angels, the holy ones and the unholy ones, the good ones and the evil ones. And he says, who shall entice Ahab? Did you know the angels are under the power of God? Even the fallen ones? They may be following Lucifer, but they know the limit of their powers. Watch this. So, God asks, who shall entice Ahab, king of Israel? What's God wanting to do? God is wanting Ahab to go and fight in a certain battle. Why? Because God's got some things arranged. He's got a young man, some soldier, who's loves to shoot arrows. Who's going to just decide, you know, I think I'm just shoot an arrow. I'm not going to aim at anything. God knows some soldier's going to do that. He says, I got to get Ahab there and get him in the way of that arrow. So God says, who shall entice Ahab to go? And that he may go up and fall at Ramoth-Gilead. And one spake after this manner, another saying after this manner. Now there's different angels that have different ideas of how to get Ahab to go there. They're having a conference. They're having a brainstorm session. Okay? Now, verse 20. Then there came out a spirit and stood before the Lord and said, I will entice him. And the Lord said unto him, wherewith? And he said, I will go out and be a lying spirit in the mouth of all his prophets. Now, is a good angel going to go and be a lying spirit in the mouth of false prophets, prophets of Baal? No. So this is an evil spirit. Could be Satan himself. And Satan's always making deals with God. Remember Job? Okay. So he said, I'll go out. I'll do it. I'll go be. Satan's looking for an advantage. Why? He's going to be able to kill people. He sees this opportunity where God's not going to tie his hands. So anyway, so God has all kinds of power to turn the heart of a king. So this angel says, this spirit says, I will be a lying spirit. And so, middle of verse 21. And the Lord said, thou shalt entice him, and thou shalt also prevail. Go out and do even so. Why? Because God knows the future. He says, yeah, your plan's going to work. You'll be able to do it. Now therefore, behold, the Lord hath put a lying spirit in the mouth of these thy prophets. And the Lord hath spoken evil against thee. Now, this is Micaiah saying, concluding verse 22, said, now therefore, behold, based on what I just saw, told you I saw in heaven, that I've now told you, now the Lord hath put a lying spirit in the mouth of these thy prophets. What is this? What are his prophets saying? And, well, here's what his prophets are saying. Go back to verse 3. And Ahab of chapter 18. And Ahab, king of Israel, said unto Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, wilt thou go with me to Ramoth Gilead? And he answered him, I am as thou art, my people is thy people, and we will be with thee in the war. And Jehoshaphat said unto the king of Israel, inquire, I pray thee, at the word of the Lord today. Therefore the king of Israel gathered together of prophets 400 men, and said unto them, shall we go to Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear? And they said, go up, for God will deliver it into the king's hands. Now we know, because Micaiah, the real man of God, comes, and this is so funny. Jehoshaphat, look at verse 7, the last part. Let's just go to verse 6. Yeah, we'll just keep on going. And Jehoshaphat said, Jehoshaphat, by the way, good king, loves the Lord. He knows, he doesn't trust these prophets. He knows these are prophets of Baal and false preachers. He knows it. And Jehoshaphat said, but he's not one to, you know, overturn the apple cart. You know, he don't want to make too many waves. He's trying to get along with this wicked neighbor, fellow Hebrew king who's wicked. Jehoshaphat said, is there not here a prophet of the Lord besides that we might inquire of him? And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, there is yet one man by whom we may inquire of the Lord. So even Ahab knows you can inquire of the Lord by this one man, Micaiah. He says, but I hate him. For he never prophesied good unto me, but always evil, the same as Micaiah, the son of Imlah. And Jehoshaphat said, let not the king say so. He's having to be a politician. He's having to, you know, be nice and not say, shame on you, king. He's trying to be real nice. Why? He's made affinity with Ahab. This is why you should never make affinity with evil people. Don't make leagues with them. But he's made a league. Now he's already said, I'm ready to go to battle. I'm with you. My heart's with your heart. My people with you, and so forth. And so now he's hearing king of Israel, Ahab, criticizing a real man of God. And Jehoshaphat knows a real man of God when he sees one. Here's about one. And so he says, let not the king say so. And the king of Israel called for one of his officers and said, fetch quickly Micaiah, the son of Imlah. And king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, sat either of them on his throne, clothed in their robes, etc. And all the prophets prophesied before them. Now, anyway, so the messenger then went to call Micaiah, verse 12, spake to him, saying, behold, the words of the prophets declare good to the king with one assent. Let thy word, therefore, I pray thee, be like one of theirs, and speak thou good. Now see, God knows that he's got a real man of God who's going to tell the truth. But God is using Satan, whoever this evil lying spirit is, to put a lie in the mouth of the multitude of the prophets, so that the king will go to battle and be there when that arrow comes flying through the air, this guy decides to shoot. Because he just likes to shoot. And anyway, so God is able to turn the heart of the king as the rivers of water. It's easy for him to do. He can even use the devil or one of an evil spirit, a lying spirit. So, anyway, so to make a long story short, the king gets mad at Isaiah, at Micaiah, and one of his men, Zedekiah, the son of Kenaiah, verse 23, came near and smote Micaiah upon the cheek and said, which way went the Spirit of the Lord from me to speak unto thee? You're just trying to intimidate him and persecute him a little bit. And hint that, you know, you don't have the Spirit of God because you're going against all these other preachers. You know, it's like nowadays, you got so many preachers preaching false doctrine. So many preachers don't have the guts to stand up and tell the truth. that someone who comes along and tells the truth is going to be criticized. Oh, what's wrong with you? You old fogey. Get with the program. You know. They don't like us fundamentalists. They don't like us liberty preaching. They don't like us people talking about our rights. Oh, come on. Don't you recognize? I mean, good night. What? It's not worth it. Our country's gone. Well, maybe it's going, but we're still here, aren't we?
Yeah.
And is God's hand shortened that he cannot save?
No.
He's not. If Nineveh could be within 40 days of saving, I think America could be within so many days and still be saved. I believe that. And so I'm going to preach the truth regardless of whether it's convenient. Okay? Now, I don't care how many people say, you're wrong. You know, there's no hope for America. Well, there won't be any hope once God decides to judge. But that's not... it's not proven yet. Hey, you look at Israel, the history of Israel. They got invaded by the Egyptians. They got invaded by the Syrians. They got invaded by other people, groups. But God's mercy was still merciful. Finally, they got carried away into captivity. At least Judah got carried away in captivity in 586 B.C., if I remember correctly. Anyway, so I believe in holding out and telling the truth. There's hope in the Lord. As long as possible. Anyway, now let's see what happens. Go to 2 Kings chapter 9. So the young man, even the young man, the prophet, went to Ramoth Gilead. And when he came, behold, the captains of the host were sitting, and he said, I have an errand to thee, O captain. And Jehu said, unto which of all us? And he said, to thee, O captain. And he rose and went into the house, and he poured the oil on his head, and said unto him, thus saith the Lord God of Israel, I have anointed thee king over the people of the Lord, even over Israel. Thou shalt smite the house of Ahab thy master, that I may avenge the blood of my servants, the prophets, and the blood of all the servants of the Lord, including Naboth, at the hand of Jezebel. And the whole house of Ahab shall perish. Now I'll cut off from Ahab him that pisseth against the wall, and him that is shut up and left in Israel. Now I'll make the house of Ahab like the house of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, and like the house of Baasha, the son of Ahijah. And the dogs, watch this. This is a prophecy from a preacher who God sent to anoint Jehu to be king while Ahab is king. All right? This is an important part of the story. And the dogs shall eat Jezebel in the portion of Jezreel. This guy is just foretold to all these guys in here, friends of Jehu, that Jezebel's going to die. And how she's going to die. Well, not necessarily how, but the result. The dogs will eat her. And there shall be none to bury her. And he opened the door and fled. So, there's another piece of the puzzle. Now turn to 1 Kings 22. By the way, Jezebel outlived Ahab. Okay? So, that's why we're going back in time to see how it went with Ahab. Well, let's start at verse 30. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, this is now they're in battle, okay? So this is the next chapter after the story about, you know, Micaiah the prophet saying, I saw the Lord and all that, and the lying spirit saying, I will be a lying spirit in his mouth and his prophets. All right, so now he's actually gone to battle. Ahab is in Ramoth Gilead, okay? Well, that's in verse 29. So the king of Israel and Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, went up to Ramoth Gilead. Just what God wanted done, you see. The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and as rivers of water, he turned to whithersoever he will. So now he's in the right place. And the king of Israel said unto Jehoshaphat, I will disguise myself and enter into the battle, but put thou on thy robes. And the king of Israel disguised himself and went into the battle. But the king of Syria... By the way, isn't it interesting? What a turncoat. This is why you don't want to make alliances with people that are not God's people. They're not going to watch out for your back. See, king of Israel wears a disguise. King of Judah doesn't have a disguise. So guess what? For some reason, and by the way, the devil thinks he can outdo God maybe by giving Ahab this idea. Hey, I'm going to disguise myself. Because the devil knows that God's going to bring bringing Ahab here to kill, and the devil's going to try and turn it to get Jehoshaphat killed. You see? The devil is so proud he thinks he can outsmart God. So he gives Ahab the idea, hey, I'm going to wear a disguise, but you wear your king's robes. Now watch this. But the king of Assyria commanded his 30, verse 31, commanded his 30 and two captains that had rule over his chariots, saying, fight neither with small nor great, save only with the king of Israel. Now, do you think they know that the king of Judah has come and joined? I'm not so sure they know that. But anyway, they have plans to fight. He tells his soldiers, fight only with the king of Israel. I want the king of Israel dead. And it came to pass, when the captains of the chariots saw Jehoshaphat, that they said, surely it is the king of Israel. Why? He's wearing his kingly robes. And see, the devil's trying to get Jehoshaphat killed instead of... See, the devil's competing against God. And he thinks he's outsmarted God. He thinks God thinks he can use me. I'll be a lying spirit in the mouth of the prophets. I'll convince Ahab, but I got a surprise for you. No, God's got a surprise for you. Because God can turn the heart of the king and of these people, because look what happens. When the captains of the chariot saw Jehoshaphat, that they said, surely it is king of Israel, and they turned aside to fight against him, and Jehoshaphat cried out, and it came to pass when the captains of the chariot perceived that it was not the king of Israel, that they turned back from pursuing him. See? God can turn the heart of people. They didn't want Jehoshaphat. They didn't care if he was wearing king robes. They want the king of Israel, and they realize that's not Ahab in those king's robes. See, the devil thought he's going to outsmart God, but God's outsmarting the devil. Okay? And so, and God's got him in the right place, though, right? Disguise and all. They don't know who the king of Israel is. How are they going to kill him? They don't need to know. Because God is able to control all kinds of things. Look at this. And it came to pass, oh, you read that. Now look at verse 34. And a certain man drew a bow at a venture. What's a venture? That's when you decide, well, whatever comes of this, I'm going to do it. A venture is when you decide to go out and, well, let's see what comes of this. The root word is vent, or ven, like ven, venga, come, okay? He drew a bow at a venture. Let's see what comes of this. He drew a bow, and then... And smote, shot an arrow, and it smote, that arrow went, and it smote the king of Israel, Ahab, between the joints of the harness, between his arm, between the joints of his harness that he's wearing. Of course, he's got a disguise on, so he doesn't have his armor on. So it's between the joints of the harness. That arrow, God directed that arrow just right. See, he caused that guy, he didn't know what he was aiming at. It just, at a venture. But God knows all the parameters of everything. And he smote the king of Israel between the joints of the harness. Wherefore he said unto the driver of his chariot, turn thine hand and carry me out of the host, for I am wounded. And the battle increased that day, and the king was stayed up in his chariot against the Syrian people, holding him up so he didn't fall over and bleed out, and died at even. And the blood ran out of the wound into the midst of the chariot. And there went a proclamation throughout the host about the going down of the sun, saying, every man to a city, and every man to his own country. Why? The king's died. So the king died and was brought to Samaria, and they buried the king in Samaria. And one washed the chariot in the pool of Samaria. And the dogs licked up his blood, and they washed his armor, according unto the word of the Lord which he spake. See, God is able to turn things. Anyway, so Jezebel got her due. Vengeance of the Lord was good. And God turned the heart of the king of Ahab to listen to these false prophets, even though the devil tried to get, knowing that God was using him, the devil was trying to outsmart God and get and pull a fast one on God and have Jehoshaphat get killed. But no, God overruled. It's an awesome story, isn't it? I just love it. So now, do you have confidence in the truth of this proverb? The king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. And so when a man's ways please the Lord, he, the Lord, maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. If we believe this, let's trust the Lord to turn the hearts of people. And how do we do that? by pleasing the Lord, to where sometimes God will turn someone's heart against us because he's judging us for something. He's chastising us. So what we need to do is say, Lord, what do I need to change in my life? What do I need to do? Lord, I want to please you. And when we start changing our ways to please the Lord, then God can turn the heart of a king, a head of another household, who's not at peace with you. God can turn him to you, to peace. So, their heart's like a river of water. He can turn it any direction. Totally opposite direction. You know, sometimes rivers run backwards. There's videos about that. And there's even rivers that run uphill for a short period of time because they got rushing waters that come and get them up over a hill, and then they make a turn. Anyway, so it's amazing. Let's just trust the Lord, all right? Well, we got one verse. but don't, isn't that comforting, though?
Yeah.
Isn't that comforting? It's also convicting. I want God to search my heart and show me if there's some way about me that's not right. So if I have some enemy, if I find that what's not right and make it right, God will then be pleased to turn that person's heart. And all of a sudden, they won't have it in for me anymore. That's what I'm looking for. All right, that's what we all ought to be looking for. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for the lesson. Thank you for your word. Thank you for being a God who is all-powerful. And as powerful as Satan is as crafty as and clever and full of wisdom as he is, his wisdom is corrupted. But you're the one that makes his mind work. You created him. And he cannot outsmart you. You always outsmart him. And so we can't outsmart you. We can't use reverse psychology to try to get you to do things. No, you know our heart. I pray that you'd help us to be honest with you in our hearts and to serve you and seek to do things your way, seek to please you. And may this lesson help us in doing that, motivating us to do that. Bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.